I want to mention, because it was brought up at the board meeting, that an apple cider membership is a swell idea for a Christmas gift. If you feel like doing it for a friend or relative or whatever, you can see Steve at the break, and if you do that, then he can whip up a gift certificate for an electronic, I believe. Is that how that would work, Steve?
Mm-hmm.
And it occurred to me, too, that it might be a good gift for somebody who is not physically able to attend the meetings anymore, but they'd get the monthly email with the agenda for the meetings and remind them to look at us on YouTube. If you have a laptop with Wi-Fi access, feel free to bring it. We share East High's bandwidth, but log on to Apple Cider, right? Like I tried to log on to East High.
Cidernet.
Mm-hmm. More stuff here, more words. We're going to start with a Q&A session. Our guest speaker, Jerry Seward, is ill and unable to come tonight, so we're going to kind of be winging it with a general discussion of internet-type stuff and wherever else we wander off to. In addition to that, on another piece of paper, it says here, that I know that Steve is going to do a thing about using photos to make greeting cards, right, Steve?
Yep, greeting cards and picture books.
Picture books.
If you haven't, how many people have got their Christmas cards mailed out?
Both of them.
Not very many of you.
And social video streaming with Facebook, Periscope, and YouTube. No. I forget nothing here. Okay, so at this point, I will mention what you were talking about before we officially started, which was Amazon and Amazon Smile, and I'll let you explain that, please.
Sure. So most of you probably know we have had a link on our website, which I have to bring back up here. We have our shopping links on the right-hand side, and we have discounts available. And let me go change cameras here. We have discounts available to many online stores and services, including Amazon. And Amazon actually has another program called Amazon Smile. And Amazon Smile is for nonprofit charitable organizations where they make an extra donation. And that URL is smile.amazon.com. And what that will let you do is register Apple Cider as your current charity. So you can pick any charity that you feel like donating money to, and we would encourage you to pick us, of course. And there's no money out of your pocket. Amazon will contribute a portion of the sales to the charity you define. If you use our Cider link and our Smile link, we get double kickbacks. We get it as a charitable donation, and we get it as a regular Amazon referral. So actually, Amazon referrals, it's been a while since we talked about that. If you sell stuff on Amazon, you can get an Amazon referral link. So if somebody buys something buys anything, you can get a kickback for that sale. And it's one of our major sources of revenue. We usually make a couple hundred dollars during the year for people buying things on Amazon. And as we're coming into now the holiday shopping season, this is the big kick. So I've gone to my Amazon Smile account, and so through my Cider link, I've generated 90 cents to Cider, and through the Smile link, I've donated $5 to Cider. I haven't done my Christmas shopping yet, so those numbers will go up from there. And according to Amazon, they have donated almost $38 million to charities. So Amazon just takes a piece of your payment to them, so there's no additional cost to you. They just take 0.5%, 1% of your of the payment and donate it to the charity of your choice. You want to go to smile.amazon.com. We're going to try to get that link up there completely. So if you start at the Cider website, Amazon Smile for nonprofits, that takes you to smile.amazon.com, where it will ask you who your current charity is, and you can search for Apple Cider. You set your charity once, and then it's already set. And then from the cider homepage, the Amazon link will take you to Amazon's website with our link embedded in it. So anything you buy gets referral to us. Right. Yep. And if you want, if you just grab that link and drag it up into your bookmark bar, then you always have that Amazon link handy that has our referral address in it. Once you set it, then it doesn't matter. So if I just go to Amazon.com, it knows... I'm sorry. Yes, good point. You have to go to smiled.amazon.com. So we're going to change that link so that it adds the smile option into that. Yeah. So now I'm just at amazon.com and I don't have the smile. Just the referral link. So probably during the break I'm going to change that link to be smiled.amazon.com. Mm-hmm. Use the link from the Apple from the cider homepage, also. So I'm gonna change this link here to have that smile.amazon.com on it, and then it should do both. Which is kind of nice that Amazon is helping to donate to charities. Looks good for their PR and their tax deductions, and we get a nice little sum at the end of the year. We also have links to Barnes & Noble and Cafe Press if you want some cider merchandise. No, it is not. So the City School District has certified Cafe Press as an adult website, so we can't go there now. It's a place to buy T-shirts. So apparently, one person on Cafe Press made an adult T-shirt and blocked the whole website. But we have cider logo shirts. In fact, we still have some for sale here if you're interested in one. They make great gifts. We also have other users group offers. We have a link through iTunes, so anything you buy on the iTunes store, we also get a small kickback for. Training on lynda.com, so if you can get a 24-hour free pass, or you can become a subscriber, we have a discount for that, for online training. And then Adam's Take Control book series, for electronic books on virtually every topic. So you know, you can go out the door in third tree on the left. Yeah, a little cold. Yeah. Why does it say October 12th is our next meeting? Interesting. That one says December 14th. Properly. Okay, so that was our shopping link. What were we going to do next? Q&A, right? Or should we let's do Apple News? Any new Apple News? So Apple announced the wireless AirPods. They're Bluetooth wireless earbuds. So of course they have to have a fun name, AirPod. They announced those back in September, and they finally started shipping now. So you can order them from Apple. They're $159, which isn't bad for Bluetooth speakers. It has a couple of neat options. They last about 5 hours on a charge, but if you don't want to use them both at the same time, say you're talking on the phone and not listening to stereo music, you can use one for 5 hours, and then you put it back in the bass. Use the second one for 5 hours. Now you have 10 hours out of it, and the bass is. Let me see if I can find a picture of it. The bass is actually the charger. So when you plug it back into the bass, it starts charging. And 15 minutes of charging gives you another 3 hours. So you can have virtually unlimited battery life out of it with just by using one at a time, which is pretty much what people normally use when they're just on the phone or things. Without actually listening to high-quality stereo music, you don't need them both at once. So they don't have to be run at the same time. And so you can run for 24 hours from a charged bass and two charged AirPods. So Bluetooth is generally designed to... connect into a device can only connect to one host, so speakers can only connect to one computer. AirPod pair to two devices. The AirPods are designed so that you can pair them to your phone and your computer. So when you're at home, you can use them with your computer and your phone, and it automatically pairs with both your devices. And I'm trying to find where that link is. So it's not as hard as pairing a Bluetooth device used to be, where you have to type codes and look for devices. I haven't heard what Charlie's referring to yet about a problem getting him to pair to two devices. But it shouldn't be a problem. But one of the reasons that they were late, I'm guessing, in fact, let me change my search tool to go to this month. They were supposed to ship a couple months ago, but they haven't. And we're guessing that one of the reasons was because they had problems getting them to pair properly. Because there were some early reports that on the day of the announcement, all the people in the demo room had trouble getting them to work every now and then, and so the Apple people would yank off one and bring it back, bring on a new pair to let it test. And I think they were letting everyone test their own clean unopened box, because you don't want to be the 50th guy in line to stick those things in your ear. So hopefully they were disinfecting them between. And one of the ways it works this easily is this new W1 pairing chip. And so it's a new generation of Bluetooth to make pairing between devices easier. So it's supposed to work a whole lot better than previous Bluetooth has. The AirPod Bluetooth speakers have always been kind of an annoyance getting them to pair and stay paired. One of the early questions was, how well are they going to stay in my ear? Are they going to fall out? And most of the people are reporting that they stay in your ear really good. For people that wear earbuds now, they tend to fall out because the weight of the cable is pulling them out. Since these have no cable, then they pretty much don't need to get pulled out of your ear. They are similar to the current Apple earbuds, or ear pods, and here's the pairing bit. And so they sound about the same as the $30 ear pods, but they have all the Bluetooth wireless and battery charging built into them, and so that adds $120 to the price. But $160 for Bluetooth headphones is really pretty reasonable compared to what other ones are on the market. Yeah, these will pair to the phone, to the watch, or the computer. And I think they will pair to two devices. Call home. That was an old practical joke that was common in the early days of Siri. When you heard the Siri chirp, you would yell out, call home or call mom, and whoever was the loudest, Siri would answer. So it calls your mom, and you can't hang up on mom. Alrighty. Yeah, so you can pair it. And so this is maybe what, Charlie, the article you were referring to about switching between left and right. So one of the things that the AirPods have in them is a sensor to know when they're in your ear. So when you take it out of your ear, the music will pause or whatever you're playing will pause. There's a button. If you tap on it, it will activate Siri. One of the caveats people have shown is that the volume control is either on Siri, so you tap it and say, Siri, raise volume, lower volume, or you go to your phone and raise or lower the volume. So that's a little tricky because it doesn't have volume buttons on it. It's not quite big enough to actually put more buttons on it. Hopefully someone will be getting them for the holidays and we can have a firsthand view of them. They look pretty cool. They should, yes, be comparable or even better to a wireless speakerphone. Because it's actually in your ear, it doesn't have to be echoey, you know, like a typical speakerphone often is. And because they have about a 5-hour battery life each, as I mentioned earlier, you wear one to get 5 hours, you wear the second one to get 5 hours. You plug it in for 15 minutes and you get 3 more hours out of it. So it can last 24 hours on a single charge. All right, let's check the Apple Hop news and see what they've been doing lately. Did we just pass another quarter? I think it was a big quarter. It was the fourth quarter. So Apple's year end just finished because first quarter is always Christmas. A lot of companies have their first corporate quarter be Christmas quarter, so that your first quarter has giant sales. But it does mean your fourth quarter is often low because people are waiting. They're waiting to Christmas to buy stuff. iOS 10.2 did come out. They added hundreds of new emoji. Also included with the new tvOS is the TV app they talked about in September. So all of your TV applications will be can be merged together into a TV folder, which I've already done on my iPad. All my TV apps are in a folder called TV. But one of the things that they have done that's a little different is that the video app that you used to have has replaced by the TV app. So if you're used to going to the video app to watch your videos, you now have to go to the TV app to watch your videos. I guess they consider all, you know, even home movies are now TV shows. So the question is about using emojis between programs. One of the problems with emoji is that every program uses different emojis, and different platforms use different emojis as well. There was an interesting controversy over the summer. There is an emoji of a handgun, and Apple released an update where they changed that emoji to a squirt gun, you know, brightly colored squirt gun. And let me see if I can actually find it here. And so what that did is if you were on a Mac or an iDevice and you used the squirt gun emoji, sent it to an Android user or a Windows user, they got a handgun. And so, you know, people were saying, you know, you could say, you know, let's go to the park and, you know, play with our squirt gun. Excuse me. Play with it. To the park and play with squirt guns, and the other end gets handguns. Excuse me. So the iOS apps, let me see if I can bring up my iOS version instead. iOS will use emoji as just part of the keyboard. And on the Mac, you also are you get your emoji as part of the keyboard, which I don't quite remember. Where is keyboard? There we are. So my emoji symbols. So if you don't know what all of the different emoji characters are, okay, it just said it's showing. So where are my emoji symbols? There it is. If you don't know what each of the characters are, you can bring up the little palette, and then you can type that into your document. On the iDevices, when you're typing, can't see my air server's not running yet. When you're typing with the normal iDevice keyboard, you can tap the Change Keyboard button and switch to the Apple Emoji keyboard instead of using the letter keyboard. You tap the Change Keyboard button on the iDevice. All right, now let me see if I can switch over there. It's in the lower left-hand corner. And I got to get my mirroring up and running here. Let me see if I can find a picture of it here while that's trying to get running. I can't spell iPhone today. iPhone, let's see, E-M-O-G-I. G-I or J-I? There we are. There's also an Emojipedia to tell you what each of the emojis really means. Generally, no. The keyboard equivalents are different for each device you're using. AirPlay, come on. So it would be different on each device. The iOS, when you're typing a word that has an emoji, it will show you that emoji in the suggestion box. Okay, Rick, let's send some emojis about. So my normal, in the bottom left, my normal keyboard, I have a Change Keyboard button, and I have a little emoji icon so I can bring up my emojis. And so these are the emojis built into iOS. Or I can go back to the regular keyboard. Now, you may need to turn on the emoji keyboard, but I think it's on by default. If you go into settings, and I never remember where keyboard is, so I like that you can now search your settings. I search for keyboard. So keyboard, it's under general. So I have two keyboards loaded now. I have English and emoji. It looks like emoji can't be removed. I can remove it. So you would go to add new keyboard, and here are keyboards in other languages, and one of those keyboards will be the emoji keyboard that you can add. Let's turn on Hawaiian and see what that looks like. So go back to messages here. Actually, just make a new message. There we go. So now I have a little globe icon, and that globe icon is the Change keyboard. So since now I have multiple keyboards loaded, I hit the globe icon, and now I'm in my emoji keyboard, and I have a little keyboard icon. Nope, that's hide and show the keyboard. There we go. Tap and hold. Now I can switch to the Hawaiian keyboard. That doesn't look much different. Except return is now Kaohai. So if you tap and hold on the keyboard icon, it lets you change between your keyboards as well. So when you're in Facebook trying to do your posts, you can bring up the Apple emojis instead of the Facebook emojis. Those are smiley faces. Yeah, in the very early days of computers, when we wanted to express emotion, we called them emojicons. A colon parenthesis was a smiley face, because all you had was raw 7-bit text. And so many programs, when you type the emoticon, it will automatically switch it to the emoji character. Was it semicolon parenthesis is a wink? Probably online somewhere. Let's do emoticon to emoji. The emoticon is the emotional icon. So the text characters that generate a smiley face, and sometimes they were just called smiley faces. And emoji is a Japanese word because that's where a lot of the early little pictographs came from. So that, you know, the emoji is the actual smiley face, and the emoticon is the, you know, colon parenthesis. And somewhere in here, they might give you an equivalency chart, probably on Google somewhere. If we search for just emoticons, there is the Wikipedia article on that. Yeah. So you can do some really impressive things with different emoji, especially if you add different foreign language characters. They're doing some really impressive faces there. The operating system is trying to do that for you. It's turning the emoticon into the emoji. Because of all of the graphic ability of the computers, it's better and easier to just use the emoji so people know more what you're showing. Well, there's the keyboard. Well, you can type the keyboard codes to get the Unicode. Somewhere there's probably a list of them all. All right, another question? Yes. So the question is about bringing in audio and playing it back out again. The issue has been complicated because Apple has been removing jacks from the computers for years. There used to be an in jack and an out jack, so that you had a line in and a speaker out jack. Later models of the computers only have one jack. It's an in and an out, depending on what software you're using. Right. If you go to your sound system preference, you can set your input devices and output devices. So right now I'm coming in from my external microphone that I have plugged into my microphone port. Or I could come in from the webcam, or if you had a USB audio device, that would show up as an in. And then I can change my out, so I'm going out. I don't know why I'm going out through Soundflower. My recordings are working, aren't they? Yeah, the recording's working. So I can go out through the headphone jack, I can go out through AirPlay. You can go out through your USB speakers. If you have a Bluetooth speaker, it will show up under your output devices as well. Soundflower is a system hack that allows you to aggregate things together. So if I want to record the radio, I've got the computer set to play. iTunes will play into the audio program. But then I can't hear what's happening, so I actually built an aggregate device. So my speakers and my ins and my outs are merged together. Normally, you don't need to do that unless you're trying to record something from the internet, which gets a little bit trickier. I don't want to change that now because I don't want it to mess up my audio. You shouldn't need to use another app. This is my just recording app. I'm recording the audio for posterity, so you can go back and listen to the meeting later. And so I'm recording from my built-in microphone. You normally have a built-in microphone in the computer, and you have the jack that is also a line in, So I've got two inputs. Because I have an external mic connected, I'm using a little iRig here. This allows me to bring the audio from the mixer into the computer. And so it sees that as an external microphone plugged into my microphone port. But for just bringing in audio and playing audio out, you can have multiple USB devices. You can have your line in and USB speakers. There's a little shortcut, too. If you hold down the Option key and pull down the volume menu, then you can switch your inputs and output devices faster than opening System Preferences. So that lets you zip back and forth. So it's getting a little trickier for podcast recorders because Apple is removing jacks. With the new iPhone 7, they removed the headphone jack. Well, we were screaming years ago because they removed the in and out. So right now, what if I want to do an in and an out? I can't. So that's another thing the iRig gives me. I'm coming in from the PA, but I also, it has a pass-through out, so I can go out to the PA. So if I want audio from the computer, we'll go to the PA. And then the output of the PA goes back to the recording, so it does a little loop back and forth. And the iRig has a very low latency. One of the things, you might notice this little monitor button here. Excuse me. If I try, in fact, my levels are a little hot. If you turn on your monitor, there's a very small but noticeable latency, a delay between the, say I was recording from a radio show and it playing through the speaker. And it's just enough of a delay to be really annoying. Yeah, sometimes it can be a quarter second, half a second, and very annoying. So that's another reason I use the iRig, because it has a zero latency in and out. In fact, if you do a lot of audio recording, the iRig is a... Is that the name of it? Yeah, iRig. The iRig is a really great dongle, or if you know someone that does audio recording... actually, the iRig 2 now. I have the old one that's round. So they have a new one. For $40, it's pretty good. For higher quality, $100. Although this does 44K. I wonder why. Yeah. So for 44K, which is typical CD quality, I bet, let me see if it has a, it probably does 96K. So you can have either more. Yeah, it does 96K. So if you want super high-res audio that no one can listen to because all the playback devices are 24K, our 24-bit 44K is a typical, no, 16-bit 44K is CD quality. So that's what virtually all output devices are. How many people heard of the Pono Player from Neil Young? It was an attempt at a very high-quality iPod-type device where things weren't compressed as much as in iTunes. A lot of musicians have complained that is decent compression to make your file smaller. It's about a 10-to-1 compression, but it can throw away the highs and it can throw away the lows. It throws away, it's called a lossy compression. So it throws away information it doesn't think you'll miss. Most people don't miss it, but some people can hear the difference. In fact, if you can hear the difference between a record album and a CD, then you need higher quality audio too. Because even with a CD at 16-bit 44K, it's doing 44,000 samples per second, and that's not enough for some people. So Neil Young was pushing this Pono Player. And I expected them on the higher quality format that it uses. Apple did upgrade the iTunes Music to now it's 256K sampling, and the AAC audio format, which was designed by Dolby Labs. It's better quality audio than MP3, but people still say MP3 because that's the thing everyone knows. If you ever looked in your iTunes list, you will have seen. Here we are. You will see the different settings between MP3 and AAC. Yeah. So regular CD is 16-bit 44K. They're using 24-bit 192K. So that means your files are a lot bigger. And in fact, you can turn off compression or use a lossless compression. The big thing that made the iPod popular was that it could store 1,000 songs. That was Apple's first slogan. It was a 5-gig hard drive and put 1,000 songs in your pocket. The very first MP3 players were like 32 megs, 64 megs, and you could put one CD on it. Well, that was kind of nice because then you didn't have to carry the CD. You had this little tiny thing. But that wasn't very much. So with the MP3 compression, you were able to put a lot more stuff on your device. Where do they move the format? There we go, import settings. So you can use Apple's AAC encoder. So this is when you're ripping CDs. And it's a lossy compression, throws away stuff it doesn't think you'll miss. Most people won't miss it. You can use the AIFF encoder, which is no compression. So your CD, 74-minute CD, is 800 megabytes of data, which is why it didn't fit on the early 32-meg flash drives. So that's no compression at all, but it's the hugest file size, AIFF. The Apple lossless encoder is about a 50% compression without losing any data. So your 74-minute audio is about 400 megs. And with pretty big, so that's half a gig. But with big hard drives, that may not be too much anymore. But MP3 compression and AAC compression are 90% compression. So your 800 meg CD gets cut down to 80 megs. And so you can fit a lot more songs. So if you like higher quality audio, you can change your settings so that you get better quality audio in the device. And Apple uses something called iTunes Plus. So if you buy music from the Apple Store, it's at 44K, 256 at 44 kilohertz with 256 kilobit data rate. So that's probably twice as much as MP3s used to be. You can go higher than that if you want on your own. And then some of the other stores, There we go. So the Pono store has the higher quality settings. I think Amazon also sells some higher quality digital audio. And most of the players these days can play the higher quality audio, but you need to check with your device if it can or not. Was that enough of a rat hole for asking about the audio jack? Yeah. Oh, hold the option key down while you click the speaker icon, and that lets you set your input and output devices. Mm-hmm. All right, so Frank is having problems sending mail, but he can receive mail. Who's your mail provider? Is your email service? Yes. You separate your mail reader is Apple Mail. And your mail service is Frontier. So your email address is frontiernet.net, something like that. iCloud Mail too, yeah. Okay. You can have multiple accounts set up in your mail program. And Frank is going to be doing a reunion 20-minute for us in January for genealogy, go along with what Bob showed off. I don't know why that message was highlighted. It knew I was talking to you when I opened my mail program. So the way email works, there is a sending server and a receiving server. So there's two different servers. One can be set right, one can be set wrong. So that's why sometimes you can send mail and not receive it, or you can receive it and not send it, because one of those settings is wrong. In the mail window, the mail program, in the window menu is the connection doctor, and that will log in to each of your servers. So IMAP is receiving mail, or POP is an older way to receive mail, and SMTP is sending mail. So it's going to log in to each of my servers for each of my two accounts. So I have two accounts set up, but I have four servers listed, send and receive for each one. And it will tell me which one is right, which one is not right. So both my IMAPs are working. Sending mail probably isn't working because the school is blocking sending mail. It doesn't want students sending email, probably. So what? So to fix your problem, you would go into your mail. Depends on what system version you're running. Apple is moving some of this stuff around. You go into your mail menu and under preferences, and since you can't send mail, that's your SMTP settings. So you would go to accounts, pick the account you're having trouble with, and depending on the version of mail you're running, you may have to go to the server settings tab. Or server might be a menu at the bottom of the screen. And under server settings, you have your outgoing mail server. So account information generally is your incoming mail server. In fact, let me set to this. No, I want, yeah, this is a Google account. That should, it's not an Apple account, so it should show me differently. And then here is my Roadrunner account. So under server settings, I've got my incoming server, and you have a name, a password, and the server address itself, the host name. And then under outgoing, you have your outgoing server name. So in my case here, since I have no outgoing server set, I cannot send mail from my Roadrunner account. So you need to make sure. So I'm gonna just set this for now. Set this to Roadrunner. And on your sending server, you also need to put in your username, password, and hostname. Generally, those are the same, sending and receiving. Roadrunner is not, because they're annoying. And in fact, it's better to use the Time Warner server than the Roadrunner server, because Time Warner lets you do IMAP. POP and IMAP are two different ways of getting mail. POP is an older system designed in the olden days when you only had one computer. You dialed in with a phone, downloaded your mail, and hung up as soon as you could because you were paying by the minute. So with POP, there's no link between your computer and the server. Your computer downloads the mail and deletes it from the server. There was an addition to the settings of, later on where your computer would download the mail and leave the mail on the server. So that on your other computer, so this is the early days of desktop and laptop, on the other computer, you could also get the mail. But that means that you had to read the mail twice, you had to delete the mail twice, because there was no link between your devices. So all the mail you deleted on your desktop, you also had to delete on your laptop, because that's the way POP works. POP is about a 40-year-old mail system. IMAP is about 30 years old. and IMAP, your mail stays on the server. And so your computer looks up at the server and says, oh, here's some mail. If you delete it on the computer, it deletes it from the server. If you read it on the computer, the server knows it's been read. So then you have your other device, so your iPhone or iPad, and also set up for IMAP. So it looks to the server and says, oh, this message has already been read, but it's not deleted, so I'll show it on the iPhone. If you delete it from the phone, then it gets deleted from the computer because all your devices are actually looking at the server. So now your server becomes, you know, what we call the master authority. So that's where all your mail is. IMAP generally requires continuous internet and ubiquitous internet, which we all have now. So almost everyone uses IMAP except Roadrunner. Fortunately, Time Warner uses IMAP. So you can use your Roadrunner address with your Time Warner mail server. And you'll have to delete your POP account, save any mail in your POP account that you might want to keep. And then you use the little add button at the bottom to add it back. In fact, most of the newer OSs will automatically set it up for Time Warner IMAP. In the early days, it would set up Roadrunner Pop. Until someone at Apple figured out that Time Warner can do IMAP. IMAP is better, so we want to use IMAP. So if you have multiple computers, you know, computers, desktop, laptop, iPhone, iPad, you generally want to use IMAP so all your mail synchronizes between your devices. Frontier adds another complication. Frontier uses Yahoo as their back-end server. So when you set up a new mail account, you want to tell it it's a Yahoo account and put in your Frontier information, because Frontier is another one. Frontier only does POP. But Yahoo only does IMAP. In fact, getting a Yahoo POP account, you have to pay extra for. So if you set it up as a Yahoo account, put in your Frontier name and password, then it will set it up as IMAP, and you can synchronize between your devices as well if you have a Frontier address. One of the bottom lines is that you don't want to use your internet provider as your main mail provider. So if you're using Frontier and decide to switch to Roadrunner or to Earthlink, you have to tell everyone your new address, because when you stop paying Frontier, your Frontier email address goes away. So if you use Gmail or Apple iCloud, your email address is not associated with your internet provider. So you can switch internet providers and keep the same email address. So you need to go through that mess now, change everyone to your new email address. And in fact, Google will go to Roadrunner and pull the mail, or you can go into your Roadrunner account and tell it to forward to Google. And until they shut off that service, then anyone who still uses your old address will be able to send you mail. Once your service is discontinued, so you stop paying Frontier, they shut off your mail service, anyone who tries to use your Frontier address will get a bounce error that the user doesn't exist. And then hopefully they'll call you on the phone and get your new address. Or they'll remember that email you sent out to everyone that I'm changing my address. So email can be tricky because there's two servers involved, sending and receiving, and there's two protocols, POP and IMAP. And you want to use the same protocols and the same addresses on all of your devices to make sure everything can sync properly. Well, if you're using Apple's iCloud address, it should automatically have set up its outgoing mail account for SMTP. This is another problem. If you change your email password, then you have to change the password on your computer, on all your devices. And you have to change it twice, once on the sending server, once on the receiving server. So that can mess people up. When you go to receive email and the password's wrong, you'll often get a message, user authorization error or something like that, and enter your password. When you go to send mail and your password's wrong, it says, please use a different server. It doesn't give you a box to say, type in my new password. So you have to edit your SMTP server to type in your new password. And if you don't have, and if you're using IMAP, one of the advantages is all of your mail is on the server. So if your computer gets messed up, just delete the account and then add it back again. And it will re-download everything from the server. Which can be tricky on Google. We had a customer the other day that had 150,000 messages on his Google Mail server, because they never delete anything just in case they need it. You know, orders that someone had made 10 years ago were still in their email. You can make folders on your own computer so they don't have to live on the mail server. The IRS might want the old email like that. So deleting the account and adding it back again can help. Apple has made things a little bit more difficult with, I think starting in, was it 10.10 or 10.11, they added a new system preference called Internet Accounts, which it's going to be opening up for me here in just a moment or 10. So your Internet Accounts have your email services, your notes, your Game Center. So sometimes when you're in the mail program and you say delete an account, it won't let you, because you have to go to Internet Accounts to do it first. So if you're running 10.10, 10.11, one of the later OSs, quit the mail program, go into System Preferences under Internet Accounts, and delete and add it from there. And then it will automatically throw it into the mail program. And if you set it up for contacts and calendars and messaging, it will add it to all of the other programs automatically as well. So it's not as easy as it could be, which is a little unusual for a 40-year-old thing. Email was kind of the first thing that the internet was ever used for. And maybe because of that is why it's so hard to do today. Because one of the things the internet likes to do is maintain backward compatibility. So you can still use Pine at the command line and get your email. And if you know what that meant, you're an old timer like me. Alrighty, so that was a long digression. Yes? Mm-hmm. So the question is about a younger grandchild who wants an iPod. And they lose things, and so what about an older model? There's a couple of different options. You can go for the iPod Shuffle, which is $49. So if they lose it, it wasn't too much. Smaller and easier to lose. It comes with a clip on it. There's the Shuffle. It has a clip where you clip it to your clothes. It's sort of designed as for runners. You want small and light to run with. There's no screen on it, so it just plays your music. You sync it to your computer, so it only is the music you like anyway. We have noticed, because you clip it to your clothes, it tends to go through the laundry. not very often. Although we had one guy that said it survived the wash, but not the dry, which I would have thought the other way around. You know, electronics hate water, but they don't mind heat that much. That might have been like several times it's done this. The iPod Nano has a screen on it, so you can pick the song you want to play. With the Shuffle, it will, as its name implies, it will shuffle randomly all your music or play them in order. And there's a next button if you want to skip a song and go next. The iPod Touch is basically an iPhone without the phone in it. And so they start at $199, which may be a little expensive for the younger kids. Excuse me. But it does have Find My iPhone built in. So you can register your iPhone and your computer with Find My iPhone, if she misplaces it, it will show where it was last connected to the internet. And if anyone does pick it up and borrow it, you'll see where it was when it connected to the internet. And so that can be an option for people that tend to lose their devices. In fact, I do that all the time. Did I leave my phone in the car, or is it in the house, or did I leave it at the office? So I use Find My iPhone a lot. No, all of the iPod Touches have that option. Yep. Since they started the Find My iPhone feature years ago. So the current generation, 16 gig, starts for $199. So you can find the previous generation's models less expensive. The one danger of the previous generation is that the battery's older. And that's the biggest thing about the iPods is the batteries will last several years. If you get an iPod that's several years old, it may be time for a battery. Right. The older iPods don't run the latest iOS, which usually isn't a problem unless you want to run the super latest whiz-bang apps. I have a fifth generation iPod Touch. We're currently at seventh generation. And I'm still running OS 9 because it can't run OS 10. The biggest problem I run into is with OS 10, you press the home button to log in. And with OS 9, you swipe to unlock. So from OS 1 to OS 9 was the swipe to unlock. When they came out with OS 10, they removed that, and now you press the home button. So I keep trying to press the home button on my iPod to log in and it won't, and I have to stop and swipe it. Although I have stopped trying to swipe my iPad mostly now because I'm running OS X, because swiping doesn't work on OS X anymore. What was called the iPod Classic were the hard drive-based iPods. And so that was the first iPod with a 5-gig drive. They peaked out about 160 gigs. Apple never went to the 320-gig model that they could have. And so if you have a lot of music, people like that hard drive size. But now the iPods and iPhones can go to 128 gigs. And the latest iPhone 7, 7 Plus, can also can go to 256 gigs. So if you have a whole lot of music or you're going to use a lot of apps, you can go to the larger sizes. Although the prices tend to go up quite a bit from there. Although at the low end, it's 16 gigs for $200, 32 gigs for $250. Quadruple the storage for $250 is usually worth it. A lot of people go for the 16 gig model because it's the least expensive, and then you're always full. And I am so glad my new iPad is 32 gigs because I'm only running 18 on it, but that's more than 16. So it was always full, and I was always running into problems. I had to delete something to get something new in. And so for a younger kid, it might even be an issue because the games that you tend to download full of graphics might take up more space. But finding a previous generation, especially, where is Apple's refurb? Apple has a refurbished store where they will sell stuff at a previous generation models at a discount. And they do have some refurbished iPods. So generally speaking, if somebody buys a product, doesn't like it, and returns it, it can no longer be sold as new. So they refurb it and sell it at a discount. So $139 for a 16 gig touch instead of $199. So that's kind of a nice discount. Sometimes the problem there is, why didn't they like it and why did they return it? Did it have a problem? Was it buggy? Technically, Apple has fixed it and you get a full 1-year warranty. That used to be a difference in the refurbs. You didn't get a full warranty. But you get a 1-year warranty and it's eligible for Apple Care. So it's not as bad as it used to be getting a refurb, but you are buying someone else's problem. But since it has a full warranty, if there is a problem, you can get it replaced under warranty. Here, 32 gig is $169, so that's still even less than a brand new one is. So that can be an option too. That's even good too. So they probably include the new battery because that's oftentimes why they were returned. A new white box, yeah. Unopened ear pod, so you don't have to have someone else's ear gunk. Generally speaking, I usually don't recommend refurbs because you are buying someone else's problems. Unless you know how to fix stuff yourself. I wouldn't mind buying a refurb because I can fix it when there's a problem. But for average folks, you have to really weigh if the price savings is enough to justify the potential of, you know, it's nice that it has a warranty, but it's terrible if you have to use it all the time. Yeah, it's not new anymore, so we can't sell it as new. Sometimes there's an in-between. You'll see sales for open box. So it wasn't really used, but the box was open. So it's not new, so it's a little bit of a discount, but it's not completely discounted as a refurb. Let me check my site. One of the things I have in my store is what we call yesterday models. When Apple comes out with a new model of something, the previous generation all go on sale because yesterday they were the new model. And let's see if I think we have a yesterday section. No, we just have consignment. So let me do a search. I don't think we have any iPods, but we never know. Yeah, doesn't look like it. At least we don't have them on our website. So that's another option too. You might find a new sealed box, but previous generation. In fact, Amazon will often do that too. You'll see a previous generation in parentheses, and so usually, if the price is too low, you want to wonder why, and so that previous generation is one of the things to look for. Clear as mud, or get in on it with the other grandparents and. Get one big gift. I had a friend that they had several kids, and they always said they would spend the same amount of money on each kid, say $100. One kid got one thing, and one kid got 10 things. And it was always hard to explain to them, no, you got one giant present. They got one, they got a bunch of little presents. It's still the same amount, but the number of boxes can matter to little kids. So sometimes just wrap up something little and big kids too, yeah. You hear that, Shirley? Lots and lots of little things to fit in the bag, yeah. Nice. Yeah. There's a comedian with Ron White, one of the blue collar comedians, has a routine on diamonds, and so the early De Beers slogans were diamonds are forever, and then later on it was diamonds, shoot, I can't, yeah, diamonds are a girl's best friend, and now one of the new slogans is diamonds take her breath away, and so he said that's close to what the actual goal is, diamonds. That'll shut her up. All right, another question? Yeah. Yep. There have been issues with OS updates causing problems with Touch ID. Usually deleting the fingerprints and adding them back again can help. When you're adding a fingerprint, they always tell you to reposition your hand. Yep. That can be too bad too. Yeah, if it's too dry, it may not work. Mm-hmm. And as we're getting into winter now, people are wearing gloves more often. There are gloves that are touchscreen aware, but they don't work on the fingerprint reader because it's a fingerprint. I have read about, if I can find them now, a touchscreen glove. Right, there's a fingerprint on the glove, and they claim they're all unique. You register that as one of your fingerprints. So then through the glove, you can still put in your fingerprint. You wouldn't make it your only fingerprint. You'd have it. You'd make it your. One of your fingerprints. So the question is, you thought on the iPhone you can only do one finger. You can save up to five fingers. So I have my, bring my iPad back up here. I have my left and my right thumb and index finger in, depending on how I've got it. So in settings, under Touch ID and passcode, I'm going to turn this off while I type my passcode. Now, this is interesting because I'm going into my Touch ID settings. I can't use Touch ID to authenticate. I have to use my actual passcode, so I have to remember what the code is. One of the options is that when you're using Touch ID, you can use a longer passcode, a four-digit PIN. There's only 10,000 combinations. Pay an intern, you know, minimum wage, and in a day or two, they'll have your PIN code. With Touch ID, you can put multiple fingerprints in. So I have three fingerprints loaded. I can tap Add a fingerprint, and I can get more fingerprints into the system. You can go into one of your fingerprints and delete that fingerprint if you want to add room for more. And then you can also change if the wrong passcode is entered 10 times, it will delete the device, delete all the data on the device. So if you're in a security conscious job, you know, lawyer, you know, doctor, something like that, if someone steals your phone and it could cause problems, you could have it set to delete. Although there is a company that has a workaround for that. They take the phone apart and put it on a computer, and when you enter the wrong passcode, if it's wrong, they shut the device down before the counter can increment and then reboot it. So they try 9 times and then shut it down before it can go to 10. Reboot it, try 9 more times. So it takes longer to do, but it's a brute force workaround, and they need your physical phone. Correct. The iCloud backup is still there. It just deletes the data on your device. In fact, it doesn't even do that. The file system on the iDevices are encrypted. So the data is stored on the device as random noise. When you put in your passcode, it opens the file and decrypts it into memory. It's still encrypted on the hard drive. And so that's one reason why the phone will ask you to type in your passcode every now and then. Even if you're using Touch ID, you still have to type your passcode in now and then to decrypt it again. So if the passcode is typed in wrong, it erases the memory, which is virtually instant, because the data on the storage drive is already gibberish, random noise. So it doesn't, because it can take time to actually erase a drive, so that would be an opportunity for the bad guys. They just shut it down or stop it before it finishes erasing. But since it's already random noise, then you just have to erase the passcode from memory. Same thing with the computer and file vault encryption. When you encrypt your hard drive, and when you load then the newer OSs, 10.10, 10.11, and later, it prompts you to turn on file vault encryption, but it doesn't give you the warnings we think it should. File vault encryption will encrypt all the data on your hard drive, so everything stored on the hard drive is random gibberish. If you forget your password, you're screwed, because everything on the hard drive is random gibberish stored under your password. And everything on the hard drive is random gibberish. If there's a block error or a bit written wrong, the random gibberish won't decrypt when you put your password in. So it makes having backups even more important, because it's much easier for a hard drive to lose data when it's encrypted if a block fails on a regular, you know, non-encrypted hard drive. You can get all the data around that block. You just lose the data in that one block. But on an encrypted drive, you can lose all the data. So I think they should give you more of a warning when you turn on encryption. The other thing is that when you have encryption turned on, every time you open a file, it decrypts it. And when you save the file, it encrypts it. That takes a little bit of time. Every operating system file is encrypted. So everything you do on the computer is a little bit slower, because it has to decrypt it when you open it and encrypt it when you close it. If you have a solid-state drive, you probably won't notice that issue. But on the older computers with spinning drives, that can noticeably slow down your computer by turning on the file vault encryption. So generally speaking, you don't need that turned on. In fact, let me switch back to the computer. You don't need that turned on unless, again, you're in a high security environment, you know, like legal or medical, where you need to have that type of security. So on your computer, if you go to System Preferences, And then security and privacy. And we'll bring that one up. And you're going to go to File Vault under Security and Privacy. That will tell you whether your hard disk is encrypted or not. So in my case, File Vault is turned off. If yours says File Vault is turned on, then you have encryption on, and that may be why your computer has felt slow. So you can you'll have to click your padlock to authenticate. You can turn off File Vault, and then it will decrypt your files over time. And that can help speed up the drive. In fact, the other issue is that when you encrypt and decrypt, in addition to slowing the computer down a little bit while it does that, it can sometimes wear the drive out faster because it encrypts the data that's on there and overwrites all the data that was there when you save the file again, so that it can't be undeleted. So we've seen some extreme examples where someone has worn their hard drive out faster by reading and writing too often. Rick? Yeah, maybe. Any last questions before we go? Alrighty. Shirley has some goodies out for us, all home baked this week in the middle of her Christmas cookies. Donations are welcome, and I can accept memberships. You can also give a gift membership to someone if you would like, and we can print you up a nice certificate for that as well. And so we'll meet back up again in say 10-15 minutes.
This is messages. Mm-hmm. Is that Apple or is that Google?
That's.
And then I have Messenger.
Okay, that's Facebook. Messenger is Facebook. Messages is Apple Messages.
Okay.
And text messages to any phone. So it's iMessages to Apple devices, which will be blue, and text messages to non-Apple devices will be green.
But here with Messenger, this Facebook.
That's Facebook Messenger.
It tells me I got one. When I go into it.
Cancel your search.
It shows them, and I have no idea who that one is. There's all these things there. Some of them have little blue things on them, and I have no idea.
So the one with the F came from Facebook itself, and the one with the squiggly thing came from Messenger. If you tap home, does it jump? I would have thought the newest one. Oh, this one is bold. So I would say that's the unread one and the non-bold one.
I've looked at that one already.
Network requires login.
Okay, well, I'm not going to put it in school, I guess.
Yeah, well, they may be blocking Facebook.
Maybe if I saw the problem on Saturday.
Let's see if they let Facebook through. I kind of doubt it. Not even getting the proxy error. But it wouldn't surprise me that the school is blocking Facebook. Yeah, and then there are other messaging services. WhatsApp is a big one if you know people out of the U.S. And so you can sometimes end up with 4 or 5 messaging apps depending on who you're talking to.
I was able to determine 3 of them, but then there's still one.
Still one you can't find. Delete the app and re-add it may work. Or try going to the Facebook website, and you might be able to add it or find that message to read it. Sure. Great. Uh-oh.
When I first started up.
Command Shift 3 takes a screenshot.
Yes, exactly. Yep. Except I had, but it wasn't in the computer.
Wasn't far enough in yet, yeah.
And it's,
shouldn't have been. It may have been looking for, so it may have been looking for the backup before the Wi-Fi got connected, or it may have wanted the Wi-Fi password, but it should have remembered that anyway, because we just did your keyboard. We had another 12-inch where we had to do the logic board, and that that does a whole lot of other issues too, but yours was just a keyboard. It probably is something we call adware that installed from an ad that tries to give you more ads, more a different search bar. Yeah. There's a My Way. Yep, we've seen that. It's probably in your Safari preferences. There's a setting for your home page, and so it may be set to that. And you may have an extension that's trying to keep it. So you change your home page back to say Google, and the extension says no, you got to go back to My Way. So you could check your extensions and delete anything in there you did. Yeah, there's two options. There's a new window, and then there's a new tab, and it can be set to open favorites or empty page or home page. So it could be remembering the last page it had open and is opening that one again. But when you make a new window, it's opening with your Google page. Yeah. Yep. Check your preferences. Make sure the home page is set to say Google, and your extensions to make sure there's no crazy extension loaded. It's another tab in preferences, in Safari in preferences. Yep. Pretty good. How are you doing? Sometimes. Oh, see, phone didn't ring, but you still get a message. Yeah. Sometimes it's a cellular issue where the cell signal was just low enough that it couldn't ring. But so it rings for, 30 seconds, and in that 30 seconds the cell signal is too weak, and then when it reconnects it knows you missed the call. Sometimes it is the other end. Is it people you know, or is it solicitors?
It varies.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a setting.
Yeah.
And there's also there's apps you can get that will leave a message without actually calling you. And I kind of like that. Well, a lot of times we'll call a customer to let them know their computer's ready, and we'll leave a message, your computer's ready. And then they call us back and saying, you called me. Did you listen to the message I left that said your computer's ready? Oh, okay, thanks. I'm finding some issues. Some people have run into that now and then. Sometimes it can be if you've got your do not disturb on, which is the half moon icon. So that basically turns off all ringing except people in your contact list that call back.
That's okay.
Yeah. And that can be scheduled to turn on and off automatically too.
Well, I'd like to have it coming in all the time.
Yeah. Where is that? Do not disturb. There it is. Do not disturb. So yeah, so you don't have it scheduled. So I've got mine scheduled, you know, from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. Don't ring. But when you get a second call from the same phone number, it will ring because it's probably important. There. So here, when the phone is locked, so this is probably your setting. Yeah. When the phone is locked, it won't ring.
Is that perhaps what's causing my problem?
Yeah.
So should I not do that?
But it's off. So do not disturb is off. So that only happens when do not disturb is on. So that's probably not it. And it's not do not disturb. We ran into another weird problem with the do not disturb where YouTube audio is blocked, but iTunes audio is not. It's an Apple program. So we had a customer that couldn't listen to YouTube videos because their do not disturb was turned on. But their music played fine. Yeah, most of the things I'm seeing here to turn off do not disturb. So it is off. That probably isn't anything you can fix at your end. Rebooting the phone will work until it stops.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I have a problem sometimes with my FileMaker app. When I want to take a picture, I see the preview, but as soon as I take the picture, the screen goes black. So I can't see what I took. But it did take it, and it does work. It just doesn't show it to me. And it's because my FileMaker is old and my iPad is new, and I'm pretty sure that's the problem. So this issue goes back several years, it looks like. Saying you missed a call when you didn't hear it ring. Uh-huh. Reset your net was an option in settings to reset network. I know that does your Wi-Fi networks, but I didn't know it did cellular. Or they say erase everything and start over again. We don't want to do that. Reset network settings. Let's see what all that resets. It will erase all your Wi-Fi passwords, so you'll have to type all those back in again. So that's something you may not want to do. Should be under general settings. Settings, general, reset. There's a reset all in there, so be careful you don't hit that. So it clears your cellular network, your Wi-Fi settings, your saved Wi-Fi passwords, and your VPN settings. So that can reset your cellular if that's why you're not hearing the calls ring. Yeah, network settings, which include your Wi-Fi and Wi-Fi passwords. Yep. Yeah. But it does look like a lot of people have had that issue going back several years. And on other brands of phones, too. No, but I did read about there's a Verizon call center that's shutting down. And
closing down.
Yeah.
At the same time, observe that parents are watching a lot of things in the picture. When you're coming from 96, instead of turning left on Phillips Road, you just go slightly forward to the west end.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
100,000 square foot building. And it's a lot of, it's currently in the environmental review stage. So we're planning for it. We're public hearing here last week.
What was the name again?
CLMSERVE. And it will increase the traffic wait time to that particular southern lines.
Accounts receivable management. I don't know if that's the right company. Is it? And they're in Crosskeys now. Interesting. December 8th. So DNC's got an article. Victor residents and businesses are divided. Probably because it's a debt collection agency. You say debt collection agency, no, I don't want them. But it's 1,000 jobs. Yeah. Average. So the one guy gets a zillion and everyone else gets tiny. Yeah. And widening Main Street fissures. Gee. I read a couple of years ago that the town of Parrington was suing the town of Victor for all of the traffic on Mosley Road going to Eastview Mall. And they wanted the town of Victor to pay for widening the road and upkeeping the road. And near as I can remember, Victor has kept saying no, and it hasn't been done. Because all the people coming down 250 to go to Eastview Mall. Yeah. And there's a giant pothole right there, so when I turn right to go home up 250, I always have to remember to miss that pothole. But I hit it every time, yeah. Oh, yeah? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah? Mm-hmm. What do they call it? Yeah, that's probably too generic a word. Nope, that's not it. Yeah. Tops friendly. What's the old joke? Why do women like Tops employees better than Wegmans employees? Well, because at Wegmans every day you get their best, but Tops never stops giving you more. I guess this is the bad pun day. Cash for causes. I forgot to put pictures in my photo library. I'm going to see if I have any. Yeah, so if you're a nonprofit organization, parent religion, yeah, I don't think we would qualify for that. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, any 501c3. Yeah, we'll have to think about that. Is any soda left? Any soda left? Thank you. All right, yeah. So when Eastview Mall was founded, there were only 5,000 residents in Victor. That's probably a password issue. You are connected to the internet. And then it might be a temporary issue at the other end. And go back in again.
Yeah.
Safer.com. So it may be the school blocking the signal too.
Oh. Yeah.
Because of the kids. Yep. Problem. Thank you. Cookies. Ah. I spilled my cookies. Oops. Ah. Well, we just messed up these brand new tables. Sorry, Bill. All right, do I have any interesting pictures I can use for the thing? Yeah, all right, I got a few. Mm-hmm. I haven't decided yet. All right, that's still recording. Good. All righty. Clear off my windows. So we'll try to reschedule Jerry. Maybe have him come in next month with Phil. Yeah. All right, so have a vote. Who wants to see greeting cards in photos first, or who wants to see streaming video? Better greeting cards. That's more topical. So iPhoto had this feature, and they included it in Photos when they replaced iPhoto with Photos, but they hid it a lot more. In fact, they hid a lot of things in Photos. When you open Photos for the first time, after it converts your iPhoto library, you get this list of your photos, and that familiar sidebar on the left that had all your stuff in it is missing. Fortunately, in the view menu, you can show sidebar, and it brings back all your sidebar of all your stuff. that stuff is still there, even when the sidebar is hidden, but it's now buttons across the top. And it makes it a little bit harder to see and find because it's different from what we've been used to. You don't often see spaceships floating down the Hudson River. Yeah, it might be the East River anyway, there too. Yeah. It's probably when it was going to the Intrepid Museum. So your buttons at the top now give you your previous and next view, and your slider bar shows you the sliding of your thumbnails, make your thumbnails bigger and smaller. But the buttons across the top now give you the things that you used to see in the sidebar on the left. And Apple being Apple, of course, they renamed a bunch of stuff. Albums are still here, called albums. And so all the albums that you had created will show up under the albums tab. And we'll bring mine up in a minute because I'm doing so much on the computer at the moment. Let's see, is my stream dead? It says it's still streaming, but my iPad seems to have died. Let's try again. So the albums that you have, they have cut things down to try to make things a little simpler. There are some people that end up with tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of photos in their library. So trying to cut down on things to help you organize them is pretty good. They've done several things in the top list, so it will show you all your photos, things that you've marked as a favorite, people you have. So if you remember from the old iPhoto, you had that cork board of people that it was called Faces then. It's now called People under Albums. So the same features are there. They've just renamed them and moved them. Places are also there as an album that used to be its own section in the old iPhoto. And a nice thing that I like they've done is they now separate your videos. So videos have their own album. A lot of times in iPhoto, you'd make a smart album where media kind is video, if you wanted to find all the videos. So these are videos you've taken with your still camera, which are different than stills you take with your video camera. In fact, video cameras have almost died off these days because and still cameras even too, because cell phone cameras have gotten so good and so ubiquitous that most people just take all their photos, stills and video. Photo Stream only does photos. So if you do take a lot of video on your phone and want to bring that into your computer, you need to use the USB cable to import it as a camera to get those videos into your computer. They've added a new thing called Memories, where it collates everything together based on the dates of the photos. So in 2009, we did our 31st anniversary party. 2010, that was probably our picnic. I don't have very many photos on this computer, so I don't have very many memories. But then the last tab is called Projects. And these are the projects that I've created. And so we've done picture books in some past meetings. When your sidebar is showing, so I'm going to go back here and turn on my sidebar, your projects are listed at the bottom. But it's a little tricky finding new projects. So if you haven't created a project yet, it won't show you any projects. So from the File menu, there is a Create Book, Create Card, Create Calendar, Create Slideshow, and Order Prints. So these are the different projects you can create. Pass these around. If you want to grab one of those. One of them got wet when I roof leaked, so don't mind the wet book. So this is the picture book you can create. And they are printed on high-quality digital printers with very high-quality acid-free linen paper. They make really great coffee table books. We've seen a lot of people will make them as a wedding book as well, and gifts to people. So that's the book feature. If we have time, we can look at that. But we're going to go to the we'll skip card for a minute because we're going to go there. You can create a calendar. So with the printed book, you take the pictures from your album and your photo library, and you create this printed book. There are multi-page formats that you'll see in the book, so you can have multiple pictures on a single page, artistically curved, and you can put captions on them, and so you can do some really nice things with the books. This is the medium-sized book. There's a smaller one and a bigger one. You can also make a calendar with your pictures on it, and one of the neat things it does is it will go into your contacts and find birthdays. So if you keep birthdays in your contacts, it will put those birthdays on the calendar. You can create a calendar with a picture at the top and then the dates at the bottom. And it can also put pictures on each date if you want. So that's a neat way to do a calendar. Slideshow does a moving slideshow with music. So if you just want to present a slideshow of your pictures. So in fact, let me go to... let's go back. Can I do air shows? Can I do a slideshow of my air shows? I have a share button. So I can, if I just want to do a quick slideshow, I can use the share button. Come on. Maybe not, because that's a network thing. So let's just go back to photos. No. This is a slideshow that only plays on the computer. If you want to save it as a file, then you would use iMovie to create the slideshow. Then it can be saved as a QuickTime file to put on a thumb drive, to give to someone else, emailed to someone, or even sent right to YouTube. But the... let's just do this one because I've already created it. The slideshow feature in Photos is just for the computer itself. So you pick the photos you want, you hit the play button, and you can load music from the from your iTunes library. There's some music built into the program, so I can let me close back out of this. So you can add there's music. So on the side here, the buttons are kind of hiding. You got a little treble clef, so you can put music in. You have a clock to set the duration of each slide. A fit to music is neat. So if you've got a 3-minute song you want to play and you've got 50 slides, it will time them automatically to fit that 3 minutes. And if I want to do a transition between the slides, it will do that as well. And I think this is where I have to change my output device. Let me do that. The stuff that Apple has in the system is already set up to be royalty-free for use in slideshows. If you use your own music or music out of your own library, it often won't save because it... can't know if you have rights to use it. So, especially if it's something you downloaded from iTunes, it knows you don't have rights to distribute it, so that it won't use that. So you basically have to strip Apple's digital rights from it, so you can use it yourself. Typically, you use another program like Handbrake would do it. That will also do video. You basically save it to a disk and import it back in as an MP3, which then strips the copy protection from it. All right, so now that I have my output set right, I can hit play. And here comes the music. So this is the Buckman Lodge at Brighton Town Park, where we have our picnic every year. And so... I don't even need to make this project. I can go into my photos, and let me go back a step here, and I want to pick a bunch of photos. Now here's Fairport Canal Day, so I'm going to select all those, and if you notice, there's a little play button over here. So I'm just going to hit play, and it's going to ask me how I want the transition, how I want the music, and I can just hit play, and now I have an instant slideshow. And so you can just make a slideshow, let it play. You would save a slideshow project if you want to control the order of the slides, if you want to control the multiple music, things like that. But it's still the slideshow in Photos only plays on the computer. If you want to create a slideshow on disk to give to someone else, then you use iMovie. And iMovie can access all your photos and build a slideshow that way. Rick? Let me see if what the export options have. No. Wow, export slideshow. It is there. So let me go to my slideshow project. They may have added that recently. Export as a slideshow. And let's see what options it's going to give me. Yeah, it's going to send it as a video. So you can do standard def, medium def, or high def. So yeah, thank you, Rick. I don't remember when they added that feature. Well, it's going to go into my movies folder by default, but I can pick what format I want it to go in. So it's probably going to create an MP4, probably an H.264. The other folders on the disk to save it into. That's just the where field, but where I'm saving it. Actually, that brings up a good point. When you save a file, a lot of people will look and give it a name, but they often don't look to see where they're saving it. And then when you want to get that file back again, you don't remember where you put it. So you have to search to find it. Or we hear this all the time, it's in Microsoft Word. Not really. It's on your disk in some folder you put it in. Yeah, you have to click on it once, and then it will show you the path at the bottom of the search window. Yeah. All right, so tonight I'm going to go back to my photos, and I'm going to say create card. Oops. Okay, now it did. It's going to do something. Let me cancel that. Since I have all these photos selected, it's going to add these photos to my card project. So you can start by picking the photo you want to put on your card, or you can start with an empty card and put photos on it. I don't need to put those 50 photos in my card, so I'm going to click on nothing to select nothing. And then I'm going to say create card. And there are three types of cards you can do. A typical folded card on letterpress. Apple was so proud of their letterpress embossing that they did a whole 10-minute video on how it works. You know, 100-year-old Heidelberg presses and, you know, great linen paper and embossed logos. Or a regular folded card, just on regular paper. Regular good paper. And then a flat, double-sided card. And at the bottom, it gives you the price of each card. And each price includes envelopes. So the flat cards are 99 cents each. These are more expensive than sort of the pre-bought Christmas cards you might buy, but they're custom printed with your own photos on it. Yep. Wow. So ordered them on Sunday, they shipped on Monday, got them on Tuesday. Paid extra for too fast of a shipping now. Wish it had a middle shipping. Yeah. Yeah, they look really, really nice. Yep. Yep. Yeah. We think initially they were all printed by Kodak. We're not sure they still are, because we're not sure if Kodak is still in the printing business. So let's select this folded 5x7. Oh, what the heck? Let's go to the letterpress, the expensive one. So you'd only send that to your most deserving family. Yes. Actually, all right. I'm pretty sure they all let you put text on them in some form. Yeah. It looks like I don't have the rest of the themes downloaded. Oh, shoot. I should have been doing this during the break, too. So you have different categories that you can pick. Yeah, so this is a holiday one. So every holiday it will change because it knows different holidays. And so there are three different ones, and now my little spinning thing is spinning, so there'll be more templates eventually. You can choose whether you want to do a portrait one or a landscape one. So let's. I'm going to create the card. My stream just went offline. Hang on a second. That says it's streaming. That says it's streaming. That says it's not. Okay, let me restart YouTube. All right, so here we have three pieces. We have the front, the inside, and the back. And I have an options button here, so I can bring up the different options. So we're on the front. I can do a one-photo front, a five-photo front with different layouts, or a nine-photo front with and without text. So this one is just photos, and this one here shows a little text at the bottom. So it will do photos and text. Subscription. So where is Cider? I like to keep my monitor running here to make sure the podcast is still, or the stream is still running, and I can't get back into it. Yeah, so it's the stream says offline. Yeah, but it does say the streaming is running. And where is it? Chrome says the stream is healthy. Oh, stream resumed. So probably it ran into an internet hiccup. All right, so we've got text at the bottom. Yep, here it just caught up to me. So we can put in text. So it picked New Year's. I guess it's too late for Christmas. Yep. And it wants to download a font for us. I'm going to say skip that for now. It really wants to download that font. All right, we'll just say Happy Holidays. And we can choose any of the fonts in that you have in your system. And spelled Holidays wrong. Happy Holidays. All right, yeah, let's send that to our Star Trek fans. Happy Holidays. And now we have placeholders. So I'm going to go to my... And so we have an... Yeah. We have an untitled project over here, and I can say add photos, and now it's going to take us to our list. So let me just grab some photos. Can I grab all? Yeah, I can select the entire. So you can click on one photo or two to select, or you can select the entire moment. So now they're all selected, and now I can say add. So it adds those photos to the project. Now I can autofill nine photos on this card, or I can go through and manually drag the ones I want to drag. So let me put that one in here. And now I'm going to autofill the rest of them. And if you want, you can always change a photo, just drag it over top. So at the bottom here, it's showing us our unused photos. Or that's pulled down a menu, you can see the photos that you've placed versus the photos that are unused. And you can always hit add photos to go back into your photos and find even more. On each photo, you have your filter options. So if I want to make one a sepia tone, that's a disgusting looking cookie cake. Let's not do sepia tone. We've got a crop and zoom where we can zoom in on one. Zoom in there. Yep. So let's say we can hit edit photo. And then it takes you back to the standard photo editor. So you can edit the photo like you normally would have when you were in the photo editing. This edit only goes into the card. It doesn't go into your full library, which is handy. So there's the front. Let me click on inside. And now this card has a whole bunch of different text. And so it's got photos left and right. So this must be the one that you picked. You've got photos left and right. So I'm going to autofill 10 of those photos. And then you can put in your text in each of the boxes. And then I can do the back. And one of the things that some people, oh, good, you can change it now, that some people used to be annoyed at. Oh, no, you still can't change it. No, I can delete it. You used to not be able to delete the, and I can't undo that I deleted it. I'm undoing adding photos. So if I go back to inside, yeah, they're missing. Some people used to be mad made on a Mac, you couldn't delete, but now you can delete it. I always thought, it's a badge that should stay there. And so if you ever want, you can, the buttons at the top here, we can go back and change our theme. Yeah, the undo there we go. Ah, here's how you'd put it back again. I can change the theme. So, so the photos may change if I change theme. So it goes back to my theme picker. So I can pick a different theme. So let's try holiday colors and see how that changes. So now on the front is just one giant picture. Inside is several pictures and one page. And back is, again, the one color. Can I put a picture? I think I can put a picture there. No, you can't put a picture on the back. But you can make it a color. And let's change our format. So you can change it and go down to the regular folded one rather than the letterpress. And now we have different options. Oh, featured. Let's go back to holidays. So the same ones. This year in review is nice because it does give you the most number of photos per card. Let's put this back here. Oh, and then that's not what I wanted. This options. Picking again. Remember that these options are there to let you pick whether you want how many photos you want per page. Autofill the rest of them. Leave the lorem ipsum. I know it'll probably warn me. So when you finish everything the way you want it to look, you can hit by card. So it's warning me that I still have my lorem ipsum placeholder text. You probably want to put your own text in before you pay $1.50 per card. Let's just live dangerously and say continue. And I'm missing some pictures in my frames. So because you're paying real money, it's nice that they're catching you, that you've got some empty frames you might want to do. So let's say autofill, put those two frames back in. Now buy a card. And it will bring up your checkout. And so this shows you a picture of your card. You're going to add your shipping address to where you're going to ship it to. Do I have my don't have my address in here. let's ship it to Apple. And then how many you want, and then here is where your shipping is. They probably are very conservative in their shipping estimates. Let's say I want 10 of those. I can type. I don't have an option for faster shipping. Oh, there it is. I'm sorry. It's up here. So standard shipping or express shipping. Since it's the card. Did you do the book or the card? Card, yeah. Didn't change the shipping. No, it did. So 20th. And before it was the 30th. But standard might be fast enough to get, in your example. Yeah. Or maybe if you do express shipping, they also do a priority printing. Jumped you ahead of the queue to do faster printing, too. Yep. Yeah, $14.99 for express. Yeah, it'd be interesting if it was shipped from Rochester. Yeah. And then when you place order, it gets charged to your iTunes account and then shows up in the mail a few days later. I was doing this with one of our customers a week or so ago, and you know, we just were throwing things in, you know, showing her how to do, you know, she had 3 grandkids, so we had to make sure they were all evenly accounted for, and then she bought 100 of them. Well, I was just showing you how to do this. I didn't expect you to actually buy this thing we were playing with. And 100 of them do. It saves itself automatically as a project in your list. I can go over to my untitled project, and I want to give it a name. Rename project. Card. 12, 14, 16. 246. Yep. So I can delete the project or duplicate it if you want to make something very similar but slightly different. And I think those commands are also up in the menus somewhere. No. Right. You can print it yourself if you have a good color printer and want to use good paper and you want to fold them all yourself. Right. So there are printing services at Kinko's and UPS and some of the other online printing services that may have cheaper cards than what Apple sells them for. So if you want, you can save it as a PDF, take it to one of those other places, and have them print it for you. Generally speaking, most of the companies have an email service, yeah. You print it to a PDF, yes. My print command is missing. There we are, print. I had to select the project on the left first. So I say print. And then it's going to ask me what printer I want to go to. And there's sort of a hidden feature in the bottom left. There's a PDF button. So I can save this as a PDF, or I can just mail it as a PDF. So it automatically makes a PDF, opens an email message, and attaches it. Or I can send this PDF as a message to someone. So I'm going to, if I say save PDF, now I give it a name, and it's remembering my movies folder because that's where we were exporting the slideshow before. So you probably don't want to put it in your movies folder. Now, one of the things Apple has done to try to make them favorite folders, this little down arrow in the side there brings open the entire save box. So now you can pick any folder you want anywhere on your hard drive. So for some people, the most common folders are enough. I'm going to put it on my desktop anyway. So if you click it again, it hides out of the way and shows you the common folders. But some people like more control and want to show all the folders. So now it's going to save that as a PDF. Yeah, so you could duplicate the project if you want to keep your old ones too. And then, yeah, just put the new pictures in. And the other projects are very similar. Create a book project. You have different size books, different bindings, different covers. I like, there's a wire-bound one. Maybe they don't have the wire-bound one anywhere. That used to be the least expensive one. The books all start at 20 pages. So when you're doing a book, you kind of want to wait until you have at least 20 pictures, if you do one per page. But you can do hundreds of pictures by having multiples per page as well. So let's select our softcover book. And there's a lot of different templates available. It's still downloading templates, so it's, we may end up with even more card templates by the time it finishes downloading. Let's do portfolio. So we get giant pictures and text over top of some of them. So now here's it showing us our 20 pages. It's actually 21 because you have a front cover, 22, front cover and back cover. So that can be there as well. Yeah, let's add some photos. Where's that Fairport Festival? There it is. Let's add all of those. Well, let's put some rockets in it too. It's still pretty fast. I just had a thought that maybe they don't have any other orders and that's why yours went so fast. Yeah. Emailing files, generally speaking, is about you have about a 5 meg limit. And that is based on your internet provider, but that's about what most of the internet providers have. Meg. So that card project we created is 10.9 megs. So it may not fit through email. 5 megs is the general email limit. Many times people will try to email photos. And especially with the higher res cameras now, each photo could be 2 or 3 megs. So you try to send 5 photos, it won't, it's too big. Google allows a larger file size. So if you're using Google to send, I think that one's 10 megs. Gmail, yep. Receiving can be an issue too. So if Gmail allows 10 megs, but Frontier only allows 5 megs, it may not let you send it to someone. So what Apple has done, I think there's an option here. When you are sending mail, you can send attachments as an iCloud link. I can't find... That just may be done automatically, and it may not have an option for it. So if I make a new message, let me just try that. And I'm going to attach, let me say I attach that card. So if something you attach is too big to fit through the regular mail, what Apple will do is it uploads it to your iCloud drive. So technically you have 5 gigabytes of space to send an email. Modified. Let's do today's card. Yep. And the person at the other end gets a link to the file, which, so your computer uploads it to iCloud, sends a link to the other person who then downloads it from iCloud. So it never actually goes through email, just the link goes through email. And right, it generates a basically a random looking link file. Theoretically, someone else could guess that link by putting in random text, but very unlikely. Apple Mail, iCloud, what did they call it? iCloud Photo, iCloud Attachment. It was a new feature they just added. Mail Drop, that's what the name of it is. So you can send attachments up to 5 gigabytes using your iCloud. Multiple email messages. Let's see. You need Yosemite or later to do Mail Drop. And it may take a long time to upload because, generally speaking, your internet upload speed is much slower compared to download, because the only thing you normally upload is a little tiny bit of text saying, I want this stuff to come down to me. So I think it is... So it automatically will ask you if you want to use, since I told it I'm already using an Apple server, it's going to do it automatically for me. So let me make a new message. I've only got my Apple server set up here. So if you use a non-Apple server, it knows the mail limitations of the other mail services and will ask if you want to send it using Mail Drop instead of attaching it directly. We've heard of some very unfortunate issues with attaching large files, and something happens at the other end and it bounces the message back, including the attachment, and then it's now too big for your mail server to read it, so your mail server bounces it back to the other end, and it gets in this multi-bounce loop until both mail servers die because their hard drives are full. We think that mail servers have been updated to recognize this multi-bounce thing and will only do it, you know, 2 or 3 times before they die completely. But the out-of-office away message that a lot of people like doing is sort of the bane of the internet. You set an out-of message, away from office message, and so anyone who sends you a message gets an answer that I'm out of the office. Well, a lot of people are on mailing lists for their company. And so every time the mailing list sends a message, everyone on that mailing list gets a notice that you're out of the office. Now, what if 2 people are out of the office? So your message is sent to him. He's out of the office, so it sends one back to you. You're out of the office, so it sends one back. So that'll bounce back and forth to everyone on the mailing list. So don't set out-of-office messages. Yeah, the message will go back and forth, but blind carbon copy just means you don't see who else it went to. And again, most mailing list manager software have been updated to recognize this bounce back and will prevent it, usually by unsubscribing you from the list for sending too much junk into the list. Alrighty. So same way you with the books as it was with the cards, you pick the photos you want. Oh, there's Matthew and his little rockets. We're getting bigger and bigger rockets now. I think, is that me going to my big rocket? And so same thing, you go through each of the pages of the book, and then when you're done, you can buy the book. And each page has, so here, this page has got 2, there we go. Double-clicked on it to make it bigger. So this is a left and right page. So I can go into my theme options, and I can choose how many pictures per page. So I can go all the way up. Didn't know they had this many. I haven't seen this in a while. 48 photos per page, or all text. If you're doing a travel photo, you can have a map page, and it will read the GPS data that's in your photo and give you an automatic pushpin map. There are also spreads, so you can put one photo across 2 pages. So those are nice. With and without text, or a spread with a little bit of text on the side. Or if you want to leave a page blank, you know, this page intentionally left blank. So you can go through each of the pages, put in the book pictures you want into each of the placeholders, and again, you know, buy your book. So it's 20 pages minimum. And then I believe if you go more than 20, yeah, it's pairs. So every additional page is front and back. So each sheet of paper, so 20 pages is 10 sheets of paper, front and back. Let's say 100 pages. Let's see what that does. $50 per book. But you can still do it. How many people have seen the Apple book? Apple put out a book, and some people are kind of critical of it. A lot of architecture firms, design firms, will put out brag books of the stuff they've done. And several people have put out books of Apple products and over the years. There's a couple of really nice ones. Well, now Apple is coming out with their own book of all of stuff they've designed. It's the Johnny Ive era, so I think it starts with the iPhone. $200 for the small book, and $300 for the big book, which isn't bad for a big photo book. Charlie, you probably got some big photo books. Nothing that big? Yeah, so, you know, like giant coffee table books. I don't remember how many pages it said. I know a couple of people have talked about it. Now here's someone that bought the book and is Apple's book bulletproof? Maybe not. Yeah. So you sit there flipping the pages for 15 minutes so you can see all the pages. Let's see. Does it say how many pages it is? Tightly bound pages. Doesn't say how many there are. Oh, it's Heaven 42 Schlüffelfritten. So Apple, there we go. So that probably added $100. It's Apple-specific paper and Apple-specific dye. Yeah. So this is a really, really good, you know, photo book that, you know, you would find for many hundreds of dollars. Some people are kind of critical of Apple for selling it and not saying we're going to donate it to charity. They're just going to add the money to their pocket. Some people are saying it probably costs more than that to print, so they're selling it at a loss. But it's really neat, and a lot of the pictures they've got are of exploded computers, so you can see all the different pieces of them. And it's one of those things that would be really cool to have, but terrible to buy. Yeah, Rick. I think we can do a little bit of it, yeah. So does anyone have any other questions? So remember, you've got your new projects, your book, your calendar, your cards. And if you want, you can just order single prints. Let me go back to my photos, and let's select this moment, and let's say order prints. And you have multiple different sizes of prints, including giant poster size, as low as 12 cents per print, which is pretty competitive with like Walmart and Walgreens, Rite Aid, those places. So if you don't have your own photo printer, you let the ink dry out in your photo printer, surely. So with inkjet printers, if you don't use them enough, the ink dries out and it ruins the printer and ruins the head. And if you use them too much, you use up your ink. So catch 22 there. So if you want actual printed photos, there are a lot of online places. We use the Target in Victor have photo kiosks where you take your SD card, stick it in, hit print, and it comes out for you. Or from your own house, you know, do it right from iPhoto, and it will show up, and in the mail later. There's also a way to do a poster of multiple photos. I don't remember how this one did it, but I remember reading a trick where you can take thumbnails and print it on a giant poster of a whole bunch of pictures. Alrighty, so I expect everyone to do some nice photo cards for holidays this year. Yeah. All right, video streaming. Many people are getting into video streaming because it's now so easy to do. And one of the easiest ways to do it, let me bring up here, is from the Facebook app. So in Facebook, come on, there we go. Oh, I didn't even think we didn't think of that when we were going to do this. Facebook is being blocked. All right, let me switch to my cell phone. So in the latest version of the Facebook app, there is a video stream option. If I switch to my phone, then I'm going to bypass the school's proxy server. And a couple of weeks ago, Mark Zuckerberg was having a backyard barbecue and just turned on his Facebook Live video and just was streaming, you know, cooking burgers in the backyard, which we thought was odd. Oops, I just lost my mirroring. Crap. I can't change my network because I can't see the mirror. How can I do this separately? Well, let me see if I can get into Facebook now, and I will grab the other network cable. And in the meantime, I will bring up Facebook Live Video. No, I still can't get into Facebook. So Facebook has a option. When you create a post, I'm hoping this will show me the pictures. I should have thought of this sooner that we couldn't get to Facebook. When you create a post, there is a button for live video. And what it does is it basically just starts streaming live video from your camera. It will ask for permission to access your camera and microphone. And then it will just start streaming. You can pick whether you want the front camera or the rear camera. And it will post that live video in your timeline and then tell your friends that you're doing a live video. Is the whole internet down now? I can't get into Google. This is going to Facebook. So I need a Google stream that doesn't go to Facebook. There we go. Let's try this one because we can't get to Facebook. There we are. That's working. I didn't do a slide in the presentation because I was going to show it live, and now we can't do it live. Where's the button? So you make a new post, and there is a... This might be a little old because the icon is different. May. No, I can't. Really? Wi-Fi or cellular? Okay, let me try again. So there's a camera prompt, and it has, and the button will then go live, and you'll have to give it permission to use your camera and microphone for the first time. Still loading. And then it will start. Then it will ask for who you want to send it to. So you can send it to the public, just your friends. Your friends accept acquaintances. So now Facebook has added more links. So it used to be friend was the only option. Now you can have acquaintance and family, and so you can have more options for that. And you can also put in a description of what you want it to look like. And then it just starts broadcasting live. And it will tell you, as you're broadcasting, you get a little timer and how much data you're using. So if you are doing a live stream on cellular, you have to keep in mind that you're using your cellular data. So if you're on a cellular data plan, you want to be sure that you have unlimited data or don't mind paying for more data. The Facebook Live video only works on iDevices and Android devices. So it's designed for your phone. Facebook for the computer doesn't have the live video option, which is interesting because you'd think you'd want to do live video there. But most of the time, the camera on your computer is pointing straight at you. But maybe you want to do a live video of you. Let me try Periscope, which was the other one. Periscope is a program that was owned by Twitter. And Twitter may be blocked. Let's see here. Yeah, crap. Twitter's blocked too. If you really want to, because we're running out of time too, aren't we? If you really want to see streaming video, come to the Q&A Saturday. And we won't have this proxy server. But what I can show you, because it is working, is YouTube streaming. Annoyingly, YouTube doesn't have a streaming video option in their own YouTube app. But the YouTube service does streaming. And what you do is you log into your YouTube account, and you may not have noticed the little hamburger icon. Some people call that the hamburger icon. And what you do is when you pull that down, you have a option for My Channel. So you need a YouTube account, which is free to create and log into. And when you go to My Channel, there's a video manager option that manages the video that you've uploaded. And to do live streaming, you first need to, I think you still need to request a live streaming option. When they introduced live streaming, they rolled it out slowly. They didn't want to give it to all billion people at once. So if you haven't got video streaming set up yet, you may have to request it. But it's free and usually only takes a day or so. And so for Cider here, we have all of our streamed videos that we have been streaming. There are two options when you're streaming YouTube. You can use a streaming from Google Hangouts, which is what we used to do. So let me see. I don't think we'll be able to do this because we're already streaming now. So you have an option under live streaming to use a Google Hangouts, which opens a website, which then streams from the website. Since we've had a lot of problems here getting to Google Hangouts, I've switched over to another program that does live streaming to YouTube. It doesn't need the website open. It doesn't need your web to do anything. But it uses a live streaming encoder, it's called. So it's a separate program that manages the streaming. There are some commercial programs called Wirecast, is probably the big granddaddy of them all. And I am going to my list of streaming here. And the one that we're using, Wirecast is $400, so we don't use it. Wirecast Pro is $1,000. We are using one called OBS, the Open Broadcast System. So it is a streaming service that will stream your data, let me go into settings here, into YouTube. So on your YouTube account page, you get a URL to stream into. So this is sending it to YouTube. Since it's not using the web, it's probably getting bypassing the proxy server. So that's why we're getting through. And so what that does is it sends it to your YouTube account. So I have this open just so I can monitor it, but you don't need anything open on your computer other than your broadcaster. And so the broadcaster will send that video into this into the YouTube service. And then anyone who wants can search for your stream name, or people can subscribe to your channel. So if you go, in fact, everyone should, go onto your computer and go into the CIDR homepage. On the right-hand side, we have a link to our live video stream. And you can subscribe to our channel. And then you'll automatically be notified when we go live. So if you happen to not be here on a Wednesday or also want to see this the Saturday meeting, it will tell you when it's live. And then you can see all the previous videos. So now this is going to be interesting because we're going live. We're watching the live stream as I'm recording the live stream. Echo, 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 echo. Let's go back to this page. And then, so right now we have five people subscribing. So at least three of them are me, my personal account, my work account, and the CIDR account. And I'm also using a program called CamTwist, which is my video switcher. So I've got my desktop loading. So normally when you're video streaming, you just have your camera pointing at you, and it's taking a picture of you. What we like to do here for the club is I've got the, in fact, thanks to Jim Bastone, is he here tonight? He might be watching tonight. We used to have a camera pointing at the projection screen so people could see the screen. I found this CamTwist program, and it's a video switcher, which used to be, you know, many millions of dollars of box that you plug all your cameras into and switch, you know, I want camera A, camera B, camera C, back and forth. So this CamTwist does that video switcher for me, and one of the video source options is the desktop. So I'm putting my desktop into the video. I'm also putting a picture-in-picture. So in the bottom corner here, I've got my camera running, and when we have presenters, I have the camera pointing at them. So I do have three cameras running if we ever need to switch between them. And I'm also putting a clock, so the date and time are overlaid on top. Theoretically, Open Broadcasting System can do all that. I just haven't figured it out yet. I've only been using this a couple of weeks. But you can set up multiple sources and multiple scenes, so I may be able to skip CamTwist. But by removing Google Hangouts, I really have simplified our streaming option and made it a lot faster to get the stream up and running. You know, just open OBS and hit start streaming, and you know that's pretty much it. So that lets you stream from your computer. If you're doing a little, you know, maybe a little more polished, you know, video tutorials or things like that. If you just want to stream some neat events to your friends, then Facebook is probably the big thing. Periscope was big. Periscope and Meerkat were sort of competing for a while. Twitter bought Periscope, and then Facebook Video came out, and Periscope and Meerkat kind of died off because everyone's using Facebook now. And that's about time. Rick? Can you stream a pre-recorded video? Basically, yes. You turn the stream on and start playing the video. Or you upload the video to your channel. So if I go back where I'm logged into my channel, I can go to Video Manager here, and I can just upload a video. One of my actions. There it is, upload. So just upload a video to your channel. They should be subscribed to your channel, and they'll get notified that a new video has been uploaded. Well, when they get their internet back, they'll be able to go find it. So all of our previous videos are available online. How long have we been doing this? We used to use another service called Ustream until they changed their free service. It used to be free for 10 gigs, and then it's free for a month, so that didn't help us any. So we switched over to YouTube, looks like about May 2015. So a year and a half we've been doing this. One of the things we sometimes run into, not very often on CIDR, but a little more often on Soundbites, which I also video stream like this, copyright infringement content. So we must have been playing some music, and that got recorded into the stream, and the music rights holders are scanning all the videos that go by to make sure there's no copyrighted music. And so they have put a copyright claim on our video. Ooh, two copyright claims. So from 2 hours, 36 minutes and 40 seconds to 2 hours, 36 minutes and 23 seconds. That's not even a minute worth of music. Apple is getting us for 4 minutes of Apple Music. So we cannot monetize the video because this is someone else's money. So while that music is playing, so one of the things you can turn on is monetization. So if someone watches your video, the ads that go in, you get a piece of it. During someone else's music, they get the money, not you. And I haven't seen any money coming in from YouTube yet, so it doesn't look like monetization does very much, unless you get huge to be able to monetize your video stream. Actually, and that picture was, I think we were doing it. Yeah, that was at a general meeting. That was a video we found from Macworld of someone who plugged 40 different things into their Mac Pro tower. So I'm surprised Macworld didn't jump on us for that. Alrighty, so that's about it for tonight. I want to thank you all for coming. I had already had that open. So this Saturday from 1 to 2:30 at Bob Hoey's house is the iWork study group, or sort of anything else that people want to talk about. And then from 3 to 5 at the JCC is our Q&A meeting. And next Wednesday night is the board meeting. We're going to be having it at the Old Toad again this year. If you're in the area, stop by, say hi. We'll draft you to be a board position. They're having whiskey and chocolate. Whiskey and chocolate tasting at 7. So some of us are going to be there early for that. Ready to start the meeting at 7:30. Yep. And also remember for weather, if East High School is closed specifically or City School District is closed, the meeting will get canceled. Sometimes if the weather comes in late in the afternoon, like we kind of expected today, the storm nailed Buffalo but missed us completely, I think. After school activities will end up getting closed. Generally, those are announced on TV and radio, so you can check for closings on that as well. Our January meeting, here we go. January, we're going to have Rick tentatively. Is that confirmed yet or still tentative? It's still a little tentative. Adventures in Self-Publishing, so if you want to publish your own book and make a fortune, maybe, we'll be doing that. Also, Saturdays at noon to 2 on FM 90.1, the Jazz Public Radio Station, is the Soundbites Radio Show. And call in question and answer. Well, here we go. Soundbites is coming up. So if you've got questions that can't wait till next Saturday meeting, you can always call in on Saturdays. All right. Anything? Any last bits? All right. Thank you all for coming. Thank the weather for holding off. And we'll see you all next year. I think one of our 20 minutes in January is going to be what you got for the holidays. So if you get anything cool, come on in and show it to us in January.